Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church. I am Pastor Debra Brady, and it is a joy to see all of you in person. It is a joy to imagine all of you online, across town, across miles, across time even. And we are a hybrid community. On any given day, about half of us come in person downtown 16th and I in our beautiful sanctuary, and half are worshiping on one platform or another. And we trust in God's mystery, who dwells above space and time, weaving us together as God's people. Everything you need will be on the screen. So if this is your first time joining us, just follow the screen. Don't worry about making mistakes. Participate as you feel led. Those in person also have a printed order of worship you can use. And online community, we have the printed order of worship attached on the homepage of our website. You can use that as well. Today, we are concluding our six-week series on spiritual affective disorder. And each week, we prepare for worship being reminded that we're a whole self when we come here. So I invite you, wherever you are, to notice that your body is with you. Feel it, notice it, notice aches and pains, adjust yourself to be comfortable. God gave us a heart to receive God's unconditional love and to love our neighbor in return. God speaks to us in our mind. So notice the busy thoughts and let them go, the to-do list, the tasks, the worries. Let those drift away and create a space for the Holy Spirit to speak with you. And our breath reminds us of the ruah that God breathed into the first person in creation, that rhythm of God's presence. Inhale and exhale a couple times, just settling and integrating yourself. Ready to hear the message, the word, the image God has for you today. Let us worship as our liturgist Roger Smith leads us now in our threshold moment.
Research shows that one of the most effective mood boosters is moving our bodies. Stretching, walking, and dancing can send feel-good endorphins coursing through us, and the change can feel like a light coming on. The Hebrew authors of our scriptures use the metaphor of walking in God's ways to help us see the benefits of our spiritual lives of moving toward the goodness of God. During our worship series, we are looking at the ordinary activities of our lives with a new perspective, seeing the potential for deep spiritual connection and nourishment in our everyday rhythms. This week, our spiritual practice will help us see our walking, or any other kind of movement, as a blessed gift of God's love in action in the world. Energizing God, we give you thanks for the gift of movement and our physical bodies. Open our eyes to the light of possibilities, even when the day ahead holds difficulties.
Be with us, near us, beside us. Amen.
opening hymn is I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light, which you may find in the red hymnal number 206. The lyrics will also be on the screen. As you are able, I invite you to stand as we sing.
Friends, it is human nature to compare ourselves to one another, and so easy to fall into the trap of doubting our self-worth if we believe that we fall short, especially as we consider how we move through the world. May we know that each one of us here in person and online is enough, that we are all unique and precious children of God. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also
with you. Will you extend words of peace to one another? Online community, for you as well, text someone if you're worshiping alone.
God of light, we come to you in need of guidance when our journey seems burdensome and the way unclear. Embrace us in your love, touch us with your word, and transform us by your spirit. Bless us in our worship that we may become children of light. Amen. Our first scripture reading is Deuteronomy chapter 30. Verses 15 through 20. Listen now for God's word to us. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall certainly perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him, for that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. This ends our first reading. Our second scripture reading is from the Psalm 119, verses 1 through 8. The scripture will be read by two members of our online community, Sue Lighthall and Cheryl Turner. Listen again for God's words to us.
Happy are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord.
Happy are those who keep God's decrees, who seek God with their whole heart, who also do no wrong, but walk in the ways of the Holy One.
You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes.
Then I shall not be put to shame, having my eyes fixed on all your commandments.
I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous ordinances.
I will observe your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me.
This ends our scripture reading. May God bless the reading and hearing of this word. Thanks be to God.
Garden sprung in completeness.
Thank you, Cathlin. Will you join me in a spirit of prayer? Oh God, we praise your name for all the ways your light breaks in to the bleakness and shadows of our lives and world. As we contemplate ancient words of scripture, will you stir in us, move in us, heal us, transform us, and then lead us on your way. We trust in the guidance of your Holy Spirit, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The story of God's people is a story about movement. People in the Bible are always on the move, migrating from one place to another. They are not always moving by choice. Sometimes they are being banned, chased, enslaved, or fleeing for their lives. Other times they are lost and searching. Sometimes they are seeking economic opportunities. And other times they are being led, exploring, or on a mission. I want to do a quick flyover just to demonstrate my conclusion about the movement in the scripture. Some major Bible stories and themes that you might know from your own Sunday school lessons or Bible study. We see the beginning of this movement in the third chapter of Genesis, the first book of the Bible. No sooner have we heard the completion of the creation stories, yes, there are two versions of it, God banishes Adam and Eve from the garden and they are on the move. A couple of chapters later, God pushes the do-over button on creation, and we find Noah and his family floating on the sea in an ark for months. Not long after that, we have the Tower of Babel and God scattering the people across the earth. Friends, we are only in chapter 11 of the Bible. Next, we meet Abram and Sarai and learn of God calling them to leave the Mesopotamian Valley and journey to a promised land in Canaan. Their travel adventures go on and on, and we eventually get to the story of their grandchildren, Jacob and Esau, Jacob fleeing for his life after betraying his brother and tricking his father. Jacob's son Joseph is sold into slavery and taken to Egypt, and eventually the whole clan moves there. In the opening verses of Exodus chapter 1, we have this quick gloss. About 400 years have passed, and then the rest of the book narrates the deliverance from Egypt and 40 years of wandering from one place to another in the Sinai desert before finally crossing the Jordan and returning to the land of Canaan. The monarchy established, and the people move from place to place in various battles involving fleeing and hiding. The capital city is established, and then King David moves it to Jerusalem. The books of the prophets are largely consumed with the plight of the exiles, moving off, being dragged off to Assyria and return, being dragged off to Babylon and then return. And of course, in smaller books, we have the story of Naomi, an emigrant to Moab, and her daughter-in-law, Ruth, returning with her to Israel. The prophet Jonah fleeing in the opposite direction that God calls him to go in before he eventually heads to Nineveh and pouts because his mission is successful and God is gracious to his enemies. In the New Testament, the Gospels are also full of movement as they convey God's action through the life of Jesus. Nazareth to Bethlehem to Egypt and back. Jesus is a peripatetic teacher and healer, itinerant, moving from one town and village to another until finally to Jerusalem. The book of Acts continues various journey stories as the gospel spreads, and we follow the Apostle Paul on several missionary journeys across the known world, planting churches. So it is no wonder that walking is a frequent metaphor in the scripture for what it means to be in relationship with God, for what it means to live faithfully and fully. In both of our scripture readings this morning, we heard this metaphor from Deuteronomy. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I'm commanding you today by loving the Lord your God, walking in God's ways, and observing God's commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. The Psalms, likewise, in this psalm and others, tell us about walking in God's laws. Happy are they whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Happy are those who keep his decrees, who seek him with their whole heart, who also do no wrong, but walk in his ways. This passage from Deuteronomy 30 is the conclusion of Moses' very long farewell sermon to the Israelites. Their 40-year journey has ended, and they are on the border of the Promised Land, getting ready to cross the Jordan River. God has told Moses he will not enter the Promised Land himself, but will soon die. So Moses gives this one long last farewell speech to the people as he reviews all of their trials and tribulations, blessings, and God's faithfulness over these last decades. Moses indicates to the people that just because their journey has reached this long hoped for milestone, it does not mean that things are going to be smooth sailing for them forever. It does not mean that their problems and struggles are going to disappear. I really appreciate Moses' honesty and his clear-eyed understanding of the human condition. Their problems will not suddenly go away once they cross the Jordan River. So often we think in these terms. We think, once we figure out the right program, our children's ministry will flourish. Once I get the garage cleaned out, then I'll be home free. Once my to-do list is done, I can breathe freely. It's not that there isn't some truth and wisdom to setting goals and reaching them and feeling that successful, accomplished feeling. The fallacy is that any one accomplishment means we are home free without a care in the world ever again. In the concluding remarks, Moses describes a choice. The choice before them is life and prosperity or death and adversity. Now, I think that this probably came as a shock to the people. What do you mean? After 40 years, we've finally gotten here, the land of milk and honey, all the promises, the stories from our ancestors. Moses, why are you even talking to us about death and adversity? After the choice, Moses presents the people with the consequences of their choice. The path of obedience leads to blessing. The path of an apathetic or hard-hearted response to God leads to destruction. And finally, Moses exhorts the people to choose life. Moses says that choosing life means obedience. Now, obedience is for me one of those words in a religious context that makes me bristle. At first, the idea of choice seems to be freeing. But when it is coupled with obedience, the choice then seems kind of controlling, constricting, manipulative maybe. Obedience, in my experience, has led to abuse, to having to comply with instructions of a person in charge that are not life-giving at all. So if you tend to bristle for these reasons, or simply because you happen to be a free spirit and you don't like rules, don't give up yet on the text. Philosophers have surmised for centuries the wisdom that we find in Scripture, that true freedom only is experienced, only comes to us when there is some order. Otherwise, life devolves into chaos. There is tension between freedom and order, the kind of order that comes from laws and rules and procedures and processes and traditions with which we are called to comply. So, for example, we only have freedom to drive our cars safely to and fro because we all agree to some order, to some rules about the speed at which we drive, which side of the road we drive on, using our signals to change lanes, people. I know all of us would appreciate if more people obeyed those rules so that we'd have more freedom for our safety. So we often think of this word obedience as meaning doing what we're told to do. As a child, I can remember my mother's exasperated reply to our relentless, "Why, Mommy, why do I have to do this?" You probably heard it too. "Because I said so, that's why." However, in the scripture, obedience involves more than a mindless following of a command made by someone else. Obedience means first to listen. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is your God." That's the beginning of the Shema that begins the Ten Commandments. We know that listening is important. We start there. But it involves more than hearing and taking an action. Obedience is a discernment process that involves all of who we are, our mind, our heart, our body, our might. Obedience in the Bible is a journey. There is a movement implied in the relationship we have with God in obedience. There is more to our faith than just intellectually believing the right thing, mindlessly following orders. Our faith indeed is a lifelong engagement with God, a lifelong movement of journey, one that is not too dissimilar from the Israelites moving from Egypt to the Promised Land across the River Jordan. Choosing life, as most of you well know, is not just a one-time decision. Choosing life is a lifelong process and is often only learned in the midst of a struggle. Choosing life really has been at the root of our reflection over these past 6 weeks as we have engaged in practices that help us deal with the blahs, a form of depression or apathy, discouragement that can accompany seasonal affective disorder in the winter months when the light wanes. In addition to therapy, private, in groups, in addition to whatever medication our physicians might prescribe, we have been tending to our spiritual affective disorder by focusing on a simple practice each week that we can integrate in our normal routines. Something that can help us be lifted and supported in the season of blahs. We often think that God is far away when we're in that mood. We often feel very alone, as though we're some kind of weirdo and it's only us in this predicament. No one else has the problems we have. So let's just review our list so that we are reminded, because these are practices we can keep up. When we talked about flipping the switch, we talked about the importance of light and just beginning each day with receiving the light God shines on us. We soothe our soul by music. We lift our spirits with laughter. We focus on others through service. We notice there are sacred places everywhere if we open our eyes, even places that we can create in our ordinary spaces. And today we conclude with a practice of movement. This week we are challenging ourselves to engage in some kind of movement, a movement that really models that journey of faith. All kinds of brain science in recent decades has demonstrated how much our physical, emotional, and spiritual health is tied to getting regular exercise or movement in some way. Endorphins are released, oxygen flows, our posture is better, our spirits are lifted. And sometimes it feels like the very last thing we want to do when we have the blahs. When I have the blahs, I want nothing more than to lay on the couch all day binging on my favorite TV series and eating myself into an Oreo cookie haze. But what I notice is that that practice at the end of the day never makes me feel better. It never makes me feel renewed. It never makes me feel refreshed. I generally feel much worse. What actually makes me feel better is to get up and get moving, especially outside. Now, our biblical ancestors, of course, did not know anything about brain science. But I think by just observing themselves and the fact that they were forced to be on the move so much, I think that they developed this inner wisdom about how important it was to understand movement as a metaphor for their relationship in community and with God, that walking and dancing and moving strengthened their communal life together. That's why they had rituals. That's why we read about dancing in the Psalms. It also helped them feel the sense of God's presence as an unfolding reality in their lives. They experienced the life of faith as discernment, as growth, as relationship, as an unfolding movement. Every Wednesday morning, I lead chapel services for our Methodist Tiny Tots students and teachers. We open with a traditional welcome song. It's a clapping song, and we sing it, and every student is welcome, and then they welcome their neighbor. And then we move into a sacred hymn called Heads and Shoulders, Knees and Toes. And we sing it twice. Now, of course, the benefit to these in this opening is because little ones, they need to move around and get the wiggles out of their body before they can sit down and concentrate on a Bible story. But when I introduce it to them, I tell them that we're going to sing this song about our bodies and move our bodies because we are called to love God with everything we have, with our heart, with our mind, with our soul, and with our strength. And they're really good at showing their muscles. So we worship God in our bodies, and we sometimes sense God leading us through how our body feels. I hope to demonstrate to these little ones that our bodies are sacred, because I certainly have been influenced as a young person by common thought in Western Christianity, where we have misinterpreted the Apostle Paul's teaching about the spirit and the flesh, and falsely concluded that our bodies are shameful and unacceptable, the thing that gets us into trouble. Our bodies are more than a structure that carries our head around. We are invited to bring all of who we are to worship God and into our relationship with God. Our whole bodies are what God created and declared good and loves and is a way that God speaks to us. So our homework assignment this week is to move. Now, I know lots of you already have exercise, movement practices every week. You might try something a little different or bring a kind of presence of mind to what you're doing. But if not, I would just challenge you to try walking a little bit every day. I always find it best to schedule an appointment with a walking buddy to make me get up and get my shoes on and out the door. Now, if you have a little more gumption, you could bump it up a little with jogging or an exercise class. And yes, you even have my encouragement to get a golf game accomplished. Get out there on the greens. Many people tell me the golf course is their favorite place to worship. Yes, you know what I mean. Dancing counts. Put on your favorite music. Dance like nobody's watching, as the song goes. Engage your family and friends. It doesn't matter if we look silly. Now, I realize many people among us have physical challenges of one kind or another. They're not able to walk and jog and dance and go to a class, right? So that's why I'm not talking specifically about walking or running, but movement, right? So things that we can do from a wheelchair or a recliner or some other kind of chair or a walker. We can flap our arms like a bird and talk with our hands like we're Italians, right? As we move, friends, may we be reminded in this movement of God's loving presence flowing in us and among us, between us. May we increase our capacity for deep listening obedience to God's instructions to us. God intends them for our freedom, for our good. May we choose life. Amen.
Let's join our voices in prayer as we sing together, "Open Unto Me."
Join me in a spirit of prayer. God of rushing rivers, warm spring breezes, God who created all the animals that run and fly and jump, and created us with many differently abled and beautiful bodies. Our paths in life are not always easy. We have all taken wrong turns, gotten lost along the way, and resisted going where you tell us to follow. Help us to walk in your footsteps, to go where you are leading us, to pick up your trail as you are ever moving through this world. May we celebrate the gift of movement in our bodies and in our hearts as we pursue a faith-filled life. Today, we pray for all of those who are suffering in mind, body, or spirit. For Margaret, Christopher, Clementine, Robin, Marcia, Bonnie, Anne, Del, Karen, Jackie, Claudia. We lift up those who struggle with anxiety and depression and other forms of mental illness. We pray for healing for all those who are struggling to maintain sobriety in the face of addiction. We remember President Jimmy Carter and his family as he's entered hospice care this weekend. We pray for our large circle of family and friends, for Myrtle, Christy, Pastor Linda, Les, Kathy, Margaret, Catalina, Nick, Ed, Mike and Michelle, Amy, George, Andrea, Kelsey and Abby. We remember all of those who are grieving in Michigan after another episode of gun violence. We remember the Kellogg and Birchall families as they are grieving the sudden passing of our brother Ron. For the Jorgensens mourning the passing of their son Cliff. For Angela mourning the loss of her father Rick. Barbara grieving the loss of her husband Tom. And in our altar flowers today, we remember Ryan Dickerson's precious life. We pray for his parents and all parents who grieve the loss of children. We lift up to you the people of Syria and Turkey, continuing in this devastating earthquake, taking the lives of more than 40,000 people, the widespread destruction. For the people in Ohio after the train derailment, we pray for all of those who are serving foster children, who are doing prison ministry, who reach out to the unhoused communities around us. We know that there are systems oppressing people. We pray that we can be a part of the dismantling of oppressive systems and agents of your healing. Help us to hold with courage and faithfulness the hope of your reign fulfilled as we pray in Jesus' name and in the way he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We move into a part of worship we call Next Steps in Discipleship. It's a place where we're going to hear an offertory, even though we no longer pass the plates. There is an offering box in the back, and there will be information on the screens about methods you can and the ways you can financially invest in our ministry. There's also inserts in your orders of worship. There's information in our Friday announcements that arrive by email about various ministries that you could just take this time to say, what's next in my discipleship? How am I going to serve? How am I going to grow? I do want to remind everybody that the season of Lent begins this Wednesday. Can you believe it? The 22nd, Ash Wednesday. So we have two worship opportunities. We're going to have a traditional liturgical service at 12:15 in the chapel. And then in the evening from 5 to 7, we're going to have a drop-in contemplative service. We're starting a new series called Looking for Love in All the Wrong Places. If that sounds familiar, then I know you're at least in my generation and you remember 1980 Urban Cowboy movie. Young people, you can stream it if you want to watch it. Our administrative board has updated our statement of affirmation, inclusion, and welcome. It is printed on the inserts online and in person today. It has been our practice for some time. It's not really stating anything new. It was just time for us to update our stance and our practices. But we realize that we have a lot of people that are new to our community, so it might raise some questions. You might want to talk about it. So today after worship in the fireside room, our administrative board chair, Belinda, our Rolachek, our lay leader, Wildebord, and I will be there just to talk it over, questions and answers, see how we might want to further engage. Please do read all the other details in the Friday announcements. They'll have other ideas. This is also a time you can complete your registration card or send us an email with your contact information, any prayer requests, notes, comments. We read them all and we appreciate it. Please do keep the prayer list before you. Lift up the joys and concerns of our community. I do want to just give one update for those of you who want to join together with us for Ron Kellogg's memorial service. It will be Friday, March 3rd at 11 a.m. here in the sanctuary, and we are going to live stream it as well. So as we've highlighted today, you also have a little insert about the ordinary practices of movement. So I just want to make sure you take that home, you look at it, right, to just figure out how to make a plan, a partnership, accountability. You can search online even for a little finger labyrinth. Like if you're recovering from some major surgery, you could just at least move your hand. This is one of them I found. A labyrinth is a contemplative form of prayer, and if you just can't move anything and you can move your finger, that would be one way of movement prayer that you could do this week. So let us now continue in a spirit of worship and discernment as we hear the offertory.
Able, please stand for the doxology.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Gracious God, we come before you with our practice of extravagant generosity, with our gifts and resources. As we give and serve, may the light of your love shine in us. May the radiance of hope surround us. May the glow of mercy light our way. May the brilliance of your grace give beauty to all our world. Amen. Please remain standing for our closing hymn, We Are Marching, found in the black hymnal number 2235B. The lyrics will also be seen on the screen.
White people, you have some work to do. Come on, we're not even Presbyterians. They call themselves the Frozen Chosen, but come on, Methodists, we gotta have a little movement here. Friends, go into the world feeling the wrap of love around your shoulders. The embrace of well-being encompassing your heart. The confidence that only requires one foot in front of the other, and the assurance that you are not alone. The world needs you and will patiently wait for your light to shine, illuminating just one small corner, speaking even a little bit of hope. We're in it together. Along with the one who created us, the one who redeems us, the one who sustains us. Go in peace. So be it. Amen.